Welcome to the meditation and Q&A. So we'll sit for 30 minutes and then we'll open up for questions. You can join me in progressive relaxation, ground the body, adjust our undercurrent feeling tones and use the method. So the three main areas to relax are the eyes, and that region, the shoulders, and the abdomen. So I won't go through the detailed version of guided meditation. We'll do the abbreviated one. So the number one place is the space around the eyes. So bring your awareness, tactile sensation, to the space between the eyebrows, the muscles hit there. See if there's any tension. One way to make sure it's relaxed is to raise your eyebrows up, tense up, and let the eyebrows drop. Do this a few times and familiarize yourself with a sense of relaxation, a sense of release when the eyebrows drop. And then extend that sense of release to your eyeballs, eyelids. Relax. Treat the eyes like muscles. Nothing to see. Just to make sure there are no tension. Your eyelids and your eyeballs. Really get a good tactile feel for them. And then relax the whole face. Wet your lips. Gentle smile. Next, the shoulders. Inhale and raise the shoulders up towards the ears. And let them drop. Exhale. Do this a few times. See if you can feel the subtle movements of your shoulders, your chest, as you breathe. There's a rhythm to it. Chest rise and fall, following the rhythm of the breath. Even the upper back. As you inhale, exhale, the subtle movements of expansion and contraction, becoming more aware of the breath. Now we can use our exhalations to relax. So exhale, release tension, let the bodily weight sink down into the seat, down into the earth. Now you can feel the rise and fall of the abdomen, following the rhythm of your breath. Sway your body from left to right, front and back. Find a center point of gravity. Make sure the body is upright, yet completely relaxed. The weight sinks down. Relax into this groundedness. Hands in the meditation posture. Left on top of right. Palms up, thumbs touching. Resting on your lap. For a moment, just feel the bottom portion of your posture. Feel the sense of weight. Sinking down into earth. And the connection of the body. Stable, still, completely grounded, rooted to earth. The body belongs to the four elements. At this time, the breath is harmonized, subtle. And we take a look at our heart. Is it pleasant? Content? At ease? How does it feel? Maybe traces of joy? Take a moment to experience. And allow it to register. Familiarize yourself with it. And then with great, great interest, fascination, bring our attention to the reality of this moment, which is sitting. belly relaxed, the concrete, palpable experiencing of being grounded to earth. Simply experiencing. The fact that every moment is a new beginning. The freshness of the sitting. Instant by instant. As if in a non-verbal way, experiencing this, what is it? Words forgotten. Wakeful and clear. The wonder of this moment, where the present moment, the experiencing, and the sitting, these three are one. If you need something more concrete as a method, then you may go to your breath. Otherwise, embodied experiencing of sitting. Great interest, no wandering thoughts. Still and wakeful. Even if thoughts arise in that instant, freshness is there. what is it? Where did it vanish to? Okay, join your palms. Move and massage. Massage your eyes, your face, your scalp. Be aware of the movements and sensations. The massaging. Experiencing in the present moment. One. Muscles squeeze, joints rub. Allow yourself to have a transition out of sitting. See them. I mean the people. Just for a moment. Take a look at everyone. Hello? Good. Okay, I promise to provide this time to finish or try to finish some of the questions from the tricycle meditation month. Those people who are new in silent rumination practice or chan for that matter. So we'll answer the questions. My assistant will select them, read it to me, or maybe she'll show it on screen for me. So I won't be able to see you the face. Look at the questions, and then I'll answer them. Okay, the first one. When I check in with my undercurrent feeling tones, I often feel numb. How can I develop a better sense of feeling my body? Very often, all of our lives, for many people, we haven't been really connected with the body. Sometimes even how we feel. These feelings are quite subtle. So it'll take a while. Usually people are just wound up, right? They're on the go from here to there. So the best way is to First, relax the body. Relax. And make sure the body is grounded. And then maybe take a look at the breath. The breath, relaxed, at ease, smooth. And then you try to experience how you feel in this moment. So when the body is relaxed, grounded, breath is smooth, when the body and breath is like this, your heart, your feeling tone, what I mean by that is your mood, to use another way of saying it, your mood, how you feel in this moment, you'll be able to access, be able to feel. Even the feeling of just being okay. Not stirred up. And not hazy, drowsy. But feeling settled. That could be a feeling, right? That could be this feeling tone. So these feeling tones are not like emotions. They're unlike emotions, which are driven by events. And it's a kind of full-fledged together, very often with subtle discursive thinking. Emotions are not really pure emotions. Emotions are always together with thoughts, ideas, memories. So I'm not really talking about emotions, kind of full-fledged, culminated experiences stirred by some events. What I'm referring to is just the reason I call it undercurrent. It's because your everyday, you know, mood, or how you feel in this moment, right, however subtle they are, actually shapes our experience. Yeah. Shapes how we perceive things, how we experience the world, experience ourselves. So it's this feeling tone that I'm talking about. So if you don't feel anything, relax the body, feeling grounded, and then maybe experience the breath, and then try to come to how you feel in this moment. Right. That usually helps. So for practitioners who are more familiar with this, they kind of cultivate this presence of mind, that they're aware of what's going on within them. The more you do it, the more you'll be aware. Right? So that even subtle shifts in feeling tone will actually manifest in your body. Some indication, some tension, or you see something unpleasant, or you hear some praise, someone, you know, there's subtle indications of the body. Right? So these are subtle thoughts. So the more you practice, the more you'll be aware, you're kind of present to yourself. The more present you are, what's happening, the more you'll be able to understand the workings and the patterns of your defense mechanisms, you know, the way you perceive things, your habits, and your relationship with other people. Right? So the mind is very cluttered, and it's very, very difficult. Very difficult. So we need more practice. More practice. So throughout the day, the mind should be kind of clear, not no wandering thoughts, or not too many wandering thoughts. Is the mind responsive? Very alive, vibrant, responsive. Our relationship, the more we practice, our relationship with our thoughts, with our body, changes. Prior to practice, we're just dictated by our thoughts. We don't even see them. We're angry, we just become angry. Sad, we just become depressed. Right? So there's no space. There's no autonomy. So the more we practice, the more we're aware of our interior state, our physiological conditions. It just takes time. Okay, but the principle is relax the body, ground, and experience. Okay. I hope that answers your question. All right, next. Oh, did you skip one? That was the same one? Okay. All right, just choose. This one. I have a hard time separating daily life from practice and seeing them as distinctly different. And yet I know that practice is important and emphasized in Buddhism. I find the same difficulty with the concept of method. Okay. Yes, practice and life is together. Okay, so we don't want to make some kind of bifurcation between, you know, this is practice and that's the reality. Going back to the real world, right? So life is practice. It is supposed to be integrated. Right? Different circumstances, however, calls for different responses. And the nature of method affects the way we respond. The way we engage with the method brings depth to experiencing the method. Okay? So, physiologically, in terms of undercurrent feeling tone that's hidden, and how we engage with the method, how we engage with people, can be very different. Sometimes very superficially, sometimes very deep. So the usefulness of the method, so the first part of your question, you know, daily life, experience, practice, same. Yes, definitely. Second part, you know, having difficulty with the concept of the method. So different situations call for different things. So if you're sitting, and if you're not aware that you're sitting, the most fundamental, not abstract, very concrete reality of this moment, which is sitting, and your mind is drifting off somewhere, is that practice? No, it's not really practice. It's just following the whims of the mind. Now, if you're working in daily life, researching, you know, doing some task, that's what's called for. So body and mind present, right there. But because of the nature of the circumstances, some circumstances you can't go deep, right? Because you're doing research, for example, like the other hat that I wear is a researcher, professor. So when I'm doing research, there's a lot of discursive things happening, right? There's critical thinking, critically reading stuff, making connections. It's not wandering elsewhere. It's on the subject, but a lot of cognitive processes. So when I do research, the conditions of my body and mind is very different. Very different. And the way I use energy is very different than when I sit in meditation when I sit in meditation, I'm not engaging discursive thinking. I bypass all that just to the reality of this moment, sitting. Now, I do sitting, so silent illumination practice for a couple of decades. And before my teacher passed away, he asked me to change to koan practice, huato practice. So I changed. He tells me, you gotta master this one, you also have to master this one to be more rounded. So part of my practice basically now, it's not silent illumination, right? But it's not, to me, it's not, there's no conflict, right? So sometime I observe a huato, critical phrase. And the way I also teach that to my students. So when I sit, that's what I'm doing. That's what it calls for. And I don't wander to this and that. Because of that, because the body is motionless, relaxed and grounded, then you can really see the power and presence of the mind. Same thing with silent illumination. You can really see and experience the profound depth that the mind is able to be present and stay with the method and be one with the method. Right? You can't do that with discursive thinking, right? Because the task calls for a lot of cognitive processes. So it uses up energy. Different tasks call for different things. When you use a method in meditation, seated meditation, if you're there and just doing nothing, then the result is nothing, right? Nothing happening. Is there wisdom? No. Is there compassion? No. So actually, there's a phrase for that. There's a phrase for that, practice of doing nothing. In the Chan tradition, we call it dwelling in the dark side of the mountain, in the ghost cave of nothingness. Right, so you're just kind of oblivion. There's no wisdom there, or it's like, you know, like you have a rock. You soak it in cold water. What's going to happen after 100 years? If the water is still there, the rock is still the same. Actually, the rock is getting worse. Probably some moss growing on it, right? So nothing really happens. So when you are stimulated by the circumstances, challenging such situations, what happens? Then you really see the power of your self-referential attachments. Because it's completely there. It just lies dormant. You don't touch it. You don't challenge it. So it's just lie there hidden. So when enticements, luring is present, yourself right come right out. Greed, aversion, jealousy, hatred. So different discriminations that we have. Implicit. Right? We don't see at all. But when the mind, by using a method, it can become profoundly refined. So any subtle shifts in the undercurrent feeling tone changes, or subtle thoughts that's happening. In silent illumination, for example, dissolves into this embodied experiencing. So the clarity with which one is able to develop, can't really do that with research. You can't really do that washing dishes. Thoughts are intimately bound up with the sense of self. So if we don't touch it, we don't expose it, it doesn't mean it's not there. It's there. You just don't know. Or the mind is vaguely clear. Not good enough. Not good enough. Soon as different circumstances, we find ourselves in the ups and downs of life, and the self is right back. Self-attachment. Self-attachment is present. We hurt ourselves, first person that we hurt, and everyone we contact. Right? That is not compassionate. So for the sake of not hurting others, those we love, those that are around us, even people that present challenges, for the sake of everyone, we have to practice diligently, with clarity, and vigilance. So the practice is not wishy-washy. Good practitioners are always very careful practitioners. Very careful. So, method has its function. But the method could be for sitting meditation, something, or it could be washing dishes, could be doing research, could be being present to someone who's sick, present to someone who is your friend, talking with them. All aspects of life, that's the method. So life unfolds as we learn to be present to them. Does that make sense? Yes? All right. So now, kind of a tangential question. Now, some people think that this method is really, really good. It's much better than that one, right? That method, it's really, really good. Or this tradition, that tradition. Then that's a problem. So, yes, method's useful. Serves a particular, it has its function. All things has functions. Right? All things. Function has a particular essence. It takes on particular appearances. Right? Essence, function, appearance. So, ti, xiang, yong. Essence, appearance, function. We have to align ourselves with it. Then things flow. So if we don't know the essence of things, we're kind of running through life, right? We don't really know how to use them, right? Don't know the function, then we're just kind of stepping over ourselves, tripping over other people. We're just kind of harmful. So it's part of understanding ourselves, understanding others, understanding when to advance, when to retreat. And everything becomes part of the path. Okay, next. In direct contemplation, is there analysis? No. Analysis, understanding, theoretical basis, you could learn them, reflect on them. But in the actual, in daily life, or when you study the Dharma, when you're actually engaged in the practice of them, there's no analytical discursive thinking. So Chan's approach is directly engage. So relax, ground, engage. Kind of bracketing this. So experiencing without filter. Conceptual overlay of things. So usually we do that with everything. Our conceptual overlay, our narrative. There's a wonderful word in Buddhism for that. It's called propancha. Propancha. P-R-A-P-A-N-C-A. Propancha. The C in Sanskrit. Romanized Sanskrit is always C-H. Like Yogacara. Right? It's not Yogacara. Propancha. This word is such a beautiful word. It means the proliferation of notions, conflating it with how things actually are. So that means how we think things are conflated right over what this is. So what we're experiencing is just experiencing our own ideas of things. It's not really experiencing whatever that we may be encountering. So in that sense, we're just living our own constructed worlds. So in our own dream. So propancha, right? There's another beautiful word, vikalpa, the discriminative aspect of propancha. Right? So practice, direct contemplation, is called direct is because it discards words, language, notions, narrative, you know, all conceptual proliferations. Right? So just freshness. In that freshness itself, that freshness itself, instant by instant freshness, that is, there's a lot of word for that too. Impermanence, emptiness, that's approximation of it. That's an approximation of that, right? Liberating moment to moment. And even the will to rest in that, or the will to maintain that, that is a wandering thought. That's overlay. So propancha. No propancha. Now the Chinese translation of this word, propancha, it's even more beautiful. It's wonderful word. It's called xi lun. Xi lun. Xi just means game. Lun means discursive. So it's like this discursive game. Such a beautiful translation. Right? That's what we do all the time. We overlay everything that we experience with eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, mind, you know, with its conceptual overlay. So all we experience through and through is just our own conceptual overlays. We don't touch other. We don't touch ourselves even. So direct contemplation. It's a very simple, one of the simplest methods, which is the most difficult to do. So, bypasses all that. The study of that, you know, through different theoretical foundations and so on, yeah, you can analyze and learn. But the practicing is completely embodiment of this. Right. Anne-Marie wrote, asked that question, right? Was it? Anne-Marie, are you there? No? Okay. Okay. All right, next. How do we know the differences between letting go of thoughts and stopping or cutting thoughts off? Kyle Kasich, are you there? Would you like to say hello? Is he there? Okay. Are they able to unmute themselves? All right, it's okay. How do we tell the difference between letting go of thoughts and kind of suppressing thoughts, stopping them, and so on. This really comes down to that undercurrent feeding tone that I'm talking about. So in trying to stop thoughts, suppress them, force yourself to stay with the method, right? So you have no wandering thoughts coming up. What is happening there is sometimes there's a tint of aversion over there in those states of mind. Repulsion over there. So when there's repulsion, aversion, simultaneously there is grasping and craving. So we want this moment to be other than what it is. I don't like this. I really want that. So craving, aversion usually come together. So when that's present, it's not really practicing. Not really practicing. So exposing the subtleties of how you're working with the method, that's very important. Very important. Probably more important than correct understanding of Buddha Dharma. Correct understanding of Buddha Dharma is intellectual knowledge. Correct views is knowledge. How you use the views, how you engage with it, how you work with it, that's totally, you know, in the Eightfold Path, you can look it up in the Google or something. Second Eightfold Path, you know what it is? Anyone? The right view and then what? Don't look up on the internet now. Right intention. Right intention. Right? What is right intention? Undercurrent feeling tone. The intention is there. The subtle framing of your method. Framing of your engagement with practice. That. Now if we are engaged with, however subtle, grasping and rejecting to use the method. So that's the cause, and what's the effect? Grasping and rejecting. You probably get annoyed. You know, we have all these wandering thoughts. Get annoyed. Or get upset. Get upset. Sometimes you may not be really upset, but sometimes it manifests as this. Sitting. How many of you do that? Right? Every once in a while, you're like, what's that? There's subtle shift that's happening there. Right? So, I have to be vigilant, very careful as a practitioner. Now, what is the right way then? We have to begin somewhere. We can't just kind of just let go, not attached. That's not possible. So usually, I tell my student to really, really love their method. Love their method. Like what? Like they're going on vacation. How many of you like vacations? Oh, a lot more people than when I ask whether people sigh or not when they meditate. You know, when people go on vacation, you know, the vacation, you know, from work, job, different obligations. Now practice, at least when you're sitting, you begin there. It's like making an appointment with yourself. So you're really vacationing. So the attitude, the framing, right? It's the vacationing mind. You're vacationing from, of course, your job and obligations and so on. One, the past, the future, the environment, words and language, and even take a vacation from your body. You're already grounded, embodied in, as you sit, right? And then you don't mess with it. Once it's grounded, so use the method in an embodied way. Right? Nothing else matters. completely in love with the method. Yeah, you use that approach, that kind of framing, that kind of intention when you use the method. So the thoughts, wandering thoughts, you don't really have to deal with them. You just love your method. Does that make sense? You love the breath, you appreciate this moment, or if you don't have a method, you know, you use silent illumination, the methodless method, the wakefulness of this moment, sitting embodied, the freshness, right? You love that, love that. So the attitude, the undercurrent feeling tone is that of content, a slight tint of joy, just being present. What happens with these wandering thoughts? The thoughts liberate themselves. In the moment, if you really examine thoughts, where did they come from? Where did they just go? Where did they recede? And even when they arise, there's freshness there. There's kind of new beginning, astonishment. There's wonder there. Right? There's no need to suppress them. Not even the need to let them go. If you have the idea of letting them go, it's probably your wandering thoughts. It's just love your method. Love your method. Okay, then the mind, the monkey mind, will settle, 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 settle. Right? Why? Because the banana that the monkey is holding, so delicious, only get to eat it, lick it once a day. Now, some of you maybe don't even practice every day, right? Maybe once a week, only once a week, your favorite food, the monkey. It's not going to get distracted. It's not going to get, it's something else more interesting. No, this, the monkey just loves the banana, right? So, or like a child, they can never get tired of sweets, like candy, chocolate. It's just tasting the chocolate. Love the chocolate. I practice like that. Sounds good? Who wants chocolate? Okay. All right, next. Do you ever try to directly look at the mind, feel the mind itself? Lee Gabbard. Gabbard. Lee, are you there? There's no mind. Don't construct the mind and then look at it. Whatever you construct is probably not the mind. It's just wandering thoughts. Right? So when we practice, it's just the method. That's the method. Engage with the method. When the method disappears, not us falling asleep. When the method suddenly vanishes through some causes and conditions, right? From scattered mind to wandering thoughts, to concentrated, from concentrated to unified, from unified, the method suddenly vanishes. Right? Then along with it, also your sense of self. That would be awakening. Right? There are wandering thoughts, but there are no mind. There's no mind. It's a kind of metaphor. In Buddhism, it's a kind of metaphor. It's a metaphor. It's not a concrete thing. Just like when in Buddha Dharma we say no self. It's not that there's a self and then you get rid of it and then you attain no self. Right? Selfless wisdom. No. you're already free from self right now. So does that make sense? So we use our thoughts to understand, oh, that makes sense. Right? That's thinking, discursiveness. Outside of that, there's no other thing called mind. Like mind is thinking. Mind is having thought. There's no two things. It's just discursive thinking, just craving, just attachment. Right? So the moment of awakening, at least Buddhist awakening, not, you know, New Age kind of, you know, enlightenment awakening, in which this kind of bliss out, right? Or some other descriptive state. In Buddha Dharma, that which have always been present, imperceptible, this continuum, right? Thoughts, moment to moment to moment. So it's not like present moment, you're thinking of having a thought. No, the present moment is the thought. It's just that we're not aware the kind of thought that's present. So in the moment of awakening, that which is always continuous, the most subtle grasping, suddenly drops away. It's like a river. We've always lived in a river. We have no idea what the river is. It's like this river suddenly ceases and vanishes. That's why when people experience this awakening, it's like a shattering experience. All that you've ever known, everything that you have experienced, it's like a dream. Powerful. And so it's not a state of mind. There is no mind. Right? Now, different Buddhist traditions, they use analogy, metaphor, like mind is spacious and open. Right? It's a metaphor. Right? So don't try to sit there and think, you know, mind is spacious. A little more spacious now. Now I see the room and I can see the space and then spacious. There's a self-attachment. That's why there's a sense of space, right? That's why there's a sense of kind of me here, right? That's because attachment's there. So attachment and the workings of thoughts and the self, mind, whatever you call it, intimately bound together. Intimately bound. So awakening is the sudden termination of this grasping mind. That is awakening in Chan. Now, is there function? Do we have memory? Do we have, you know, do our minds work? Of course it works. But in this situation, the Buddha Dharma no longer calls that mind, no longer calls that thoughts. What do we call it then? Wisdom. Just prajna. There's a different word for it. So prajna, wisdom, without self. Compassion, no other. Othering, right? No sentient beings. Right? Definitely no opposition. Right? No obstacles. That's compassion. So this is how the Chan tradition. So do we feel whatever we feel in meditation? It's just you're feeding your thoughts. Right? Whatever we look at in meditation, we're looking at our thoughts. Former thought, looking at the subsequent thought. Former thought, looking at the subsequent thought. Like a link chain. So most people's link chain is so scattered and fragmented. So we call that scatter thought. Need a method to concentrate it. If you don't have a method, you may think you're doing perfectly fine. Actually, so much delusion beneath the layer of fine. You just don't know it. So use a method from scattered thought to concentrated. Concentrated to unified. Unified to So through the teacher's direct pointing or the merit from your own fortune, from your own merit, you see something, hear something in that state, suddenly self drops away. If it's a small glimpse, like 10 minutes, that doesn't count. Just kind of like blind cat suddenly stumble into something. So awakening, much longer. And then you will see the self comes back, right? Trickling back. Thoughts begin, self-referential tendencies. And you will see exactly how they come back. Practice continues, continue. Right, so you have these penetrated, dropping away again and again and again and again until thoroughly awakened. Thoroughly awakened doesn't mean practice is over, practice continues. Right? No longer do we practice for others, do we practice for ourselves. No longer do we have to say, oh, I vow to save all sentient beings. No need to do that. Yet, sentient beings are saved. Sentient beings, living beings, liberate themselves. And we offer ourselves. Right? Without saying, I'm offering myself. Right? So, practice continues. Endless practice. So, that's the Chan tradition. Okay, next. That's it. Wow, okay. Yes, if you have questions, please feel free to unmute yourself. We can try to entertain some questions. If you want to say hello, you can do that too. Yes, please unmute yourself. Yes, sir.
Hello.
So, hello there, and thank you very much. Mm-hmm. You keep talking about the method, but you kind of always talk around it. I'd kind of like to know exactly what this method is. Mm.
Okay, so there are different methods. That's why I'm not referring to one, you see? Yeah. So, when you sit, what do?
I sit shikantaza.
Okay. So just sitting.
Just sitting.
So that would be what the Chan tradition call your method. I know the Japanese Zen Soto tradition, they don't like to use the word method. But from the Chan tradition, okay, this person is using shikantaza. There's a word for it. So, shikantaza means just sitting. Literal translation has this flavor of, you know, the colloquial usage in pre-modern and modern time. It has this flavor of just mind your own business. Right? And what is that business? Like sitting. Just mind your own sitting. It's almost like it has that nuance there. So when you're sitting, what we're doing is, we're sitting. So do you know you're sitting? So if you're sitting, the reality and the simplicity of this moment is sitting. So the mind is sitting. The body is sitting. Sitting and the present. And the embodied experiencing. These three are one. Sitting. Wakeful. Now, if we're not awake, we're drowsy, that means we're not doing shikantaza. If we're counting breath, that means we're using anapanasati, right? Now, if we're listening to sounds, that's another method. It's called contemplation sound, right? So it's a kind of formless, methodless method. And in this moment, you happen to be together with the reality of this moment, which is sitting. And you're completely, your mind in sitting. Right? With your whole being. Right? With your whole being. like eye, ears, nose, tongue, body, mind, sit. Now, if we're thinking, sit, heart, shikantaza, shikantaza. Wandering thought, okay, shikantaza, shikantaza. Then we're thinking, right? So we're kind of, we're in the conceptual overlay again, the propancha again, you see? So usually this method, we have to have a good solid foundation, right? So people doing shikantaza, they work with the breath first, sit, feel grounded, and then slowly they can let go of the crutch of the breath, you see? And then let go of even this notion, idea. Now, are they awake? Fully vibrant, fully awake. Are they in samadhi? No, they're not. Now, if a person truly doing shikantaza, they enter into meditative absorption, then they're not doing shikantaza. You see, so this method is such a wonderful, wonderful method. Neither engage in discursive thinking, nor enter into samadhi. Wakeful, yet still. Still, yet vibrant. So, three in one. Right, the present, embodiment, sitting, the experiencing. Moment to moment. That's shikantaza.
Yeah. So that's my personal method. You would say that that would be my method. With
that's
somebody
method.
Else.
That would
somebody
be your
else.
Method.
So somebody else would have another method, a different method.
That's right.
But they go to the you get the same result.
Well, different result. maybe until the end. So each method has its own scenery. Scenery is like walking down a path. You take a shortcut, someone else take the long road. Take a long road, not necessarily bad. They actually see a lot of things. They experience a lot. So their experience become enriched. You see? So they may use meditation on the breath. Excellent method. So using a particular method, that method itself will take the practitioner to see and experience different sceneries. Some methods in Buddhism is designed, or Chan, Zen, are designed to generate a particular function. Like I said before, appearance, function, essence. Now if you use koan practice, now the end result may be the same, but the path is completely different. You know, if you use the koan, meditating on the critical phrase, the sense of wonderment, that's the function. It's supposed to generate a sense of not knowing, sense of wonder, nonverbal, irresolvable impasse. So it's kind of not knowing. Right? It's not the phrasing, it's not the words or the story that, you know, we ruminate about. It's this identity and embodiment of the meaning of this phrase. Like, what is ooh. Does a dog have Buddha nature? No. And the no is not the yes and no, no. It's just ooh. So it's like, what does it mean? Where does it come from? Where does it go? What is it? No, no, don't know. So we're supposed to have this kind of flavor. So that would be the undercurrent feeling tone. You see, that I spoke about earlier? So every method have a different quality, different appearance, function. Now, if you do loving kindness, you're not there asking, like, what is it, what is it, what is it? So the undercurrent feeling tone is that of well-being, sense of goodwill, and you cultivate. So it infuses every aspect of your being, or yourself. And then when you direct that concentration to someone, wishing that person well, then the minds and hearts meet. You know, now if we're, you know, sending radio waves and it's all scattered up here, then nothing's going to meet. It's just wandering thoughts, right? But if the concentration is there, and the hearts will meet. You see, that's why loving kindness, the Buddha taught. You have to meditate on loving kindness with someone who's alive. Right? That's one of the prerequisites of that method. You can't meditate on someone who passed away. Why? It's not there. You're sending a message and there's like no receiver there. You see? So every method has its own course. Essence, function, appearance.
Good enough for me.
Thank you. All right. We got a few minutes left. Maybe entertain one more question.
Hi. Hello?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Mitchell.
Hi, Mitchell.
How are you?
Good. Thank you.
I have a question. Do people address you as a sifu?
Yeah, some students do that, even though I tell them not to. Yeah, I tell people just to call me Guagu.
Okay. Yeah. And Guagu, another question. You mentioned that there are four elements. I practice Qigong and we practice five elements. Why is there an element missing in Chan Buddhism?
Which five elements?
Wood, earth, metal, water, and
fire.
And fire.
Sorry to put you on the spot. You almost named only four elements.
You got me nervous.
Sorry. Almost named four elements there. Now, for Buddha Dharma, there's also five elements. Sometimes space is included. Now, the Qigong practice, it has its own provenance, you know, to kind of ancient Chinese Taoist practice, whereas Buddha Dharma, its provenance is India, right? So the fifth element in Buddha Dharma is not wood. Why? Because from the Buddhist perspective, wood will dissolve and become dirt, will become earth, right? So the fifth element is actually space. Space, yeah. So space, unconditioned. Unconditioned is qualitatively different than earth, water, fire, wind. Yeah. So either way is fine. Nah, either way, whichever way you feel comfortable. Okay, you're muted.
Oh, thank you, Guagu.
Oh, yeah, no problem. Thank you. Okay, we got 1 minute. One quick question. And I can just respond by cut! A loud scream, or just, it's all good.
One minute question. When I've been meditating on perceptions, especially the visual perceptions, keeping in mind your teaching, sharing the teaching from neuroscience that 90% of what we perceive visually is fabricated by our minds. At first, this seemed to have kind of a claustrophobic feel to it, like I'm just seeing my consciousness or... In losing touch, it's like I'm no longer in touch with the outside world. I'm just, what I'm seeing is a fabrication of my mind. And I had a question about that, but where I am with that right now is I'm just seeing visual appearances the same way as I see thoughts or emotions or other things that arise, and to just kind of hold them, you know, without attachment or aversion, and just, you know, let them be, and, you know, kind of have the same type of approach that I work with thoughts. And I'm wondering, is that, am I on the right track there? Is there a different way I should be working with that?
Yeah. Okay. So all the Buddhist teachings, every single one of them, are expedient means that arise, were taught, in a particular context for a particular purpose, function. Right? So the reason for the teaching that of Yogacara, that all things are construct of the mind, is for us to not to reify and solidify and other people and things and all of our attachment, habit, tendencies. So that's the purpose, that's the aim. Now if we use a particular teaching and we have some adverse effect, then don't use it. Don't use it, you know. So these teachings are kind of, the teachings are kind of dead, you know, they, especially when they are printed in words, in books, and it's kind of frozen, you know, in time, as if it's kind of unchanging, you know. But these teachings arise spontaneously from in response to the needs of people. So, you know, if we use that teaching and we start to feel that, you know, just claustrophobic or experiencing my own interior state, everything is just like here, then come to the body, relax, relax, ground yourself, and just experience the freshness. That's sufficient, the freshness. Don't worry about whether it's inside or outside, produce 90% or 10% is real. Wow, I never living the world. I've only been living in my mind. Forget about that. Forget about it. Yeah, just experience freshness. Or some people, maybe yourself, may like the teaching that, you know, the teaching of connectedness. You know, the way I teach emptiness, sometimes I rephrase that to emptiness means relationships, connectedness, which is just pratittha-samuppada, dependent origination. Does that make sense? Yeah. Connectedness. Yeah. All right.
Thank you. Yeah.
All right. Have a good night, everyone. Wish you the best. Love yourself. Take care.